That's good. Amen. That's his truth is marching on. I'm sitting there thinking about why she's playing. The Bible says God's a jealous God. You let somebody mess with Israel as a nation, God won't put up with it. Could I say to you, even greater than that, or as great as that is, he has a bride too. And his bride is his church. And so you let the government mess with his church and try to suppress it and stop it, you can't stop something that's marching on. Because he said the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So as the church of living God marches on, this old world thinks, well, we're going to hush those Christians up. No, you're not either. It may cost us a lot of blood and sacrifice, and he said that, but it'll march on, amen, with him as the victor. All right, praise the Lord. Okay, aren't you glad of that? Marching on, amen. All right, Brother Tommy, y'all come, and Sister Beckham, you come, and looking forward to hearing you sing tonight. What a blessing it is. All right.
Trade contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall the saints and angels' song.
Amen. Boy, we got to have some more of that. Amen. That's wonderful. Thank you, Sister Jeanette. That's great. Boy, what about His love? Nobody can love like the Lord. We try, but we can't do it. And if we are able to love, it's because of His love in us. All right. Well, I say it all the time. Sit up straight. Wake up. Sit up. Get your Bibles now. And I think we know where we're going with this thing. What chapter are we going to be in? Psalm 139. Is that correct, preacher? All right. Might as well go ahead and get there. And he'll just preach what the Lord lays on his heart to preach. And you do what God tells you to do. Just mind God. That's all we care about. And that's all He cares about. So, Brother Benny, you come tonight. Brother Benny Beckham, our good friend. And we sure love him. And he loves us. Amen.
Amen, Brother Baker. God bless you, my Amen. Friend. God bless you. I love you. And I love you too, church. And thank you, Jeanette, for that fine song and the choir. Thank you. And that piano special. Thank you for that. It was just wonderful. And let me ask you a question. Have you talked to the Father this afternoon?
Yes,
see, people think you have to be on your knees and have to be your back folded and your hands folded and your eyes closed to be in prayer. But you don't. Paul said, pray without ceasing. Pray everywhere. So you can just be sitting in an easy chair somewhere, just praying, just talking to the Lord, and not saying a word, but your heart speaking.
That's right.
And
Amen.
So prayer is a wonderful thing. Intercessory prayer is so wonderful, and I love it. I am so glad that God put me in the prayer ministry. And in the early days, all my friends, they said, preacher, when you go through your friends, you'll never get another meeting. People is not concerned about this prayer thing. And, God proved them wrong.
That's
Amen.
Right. Amen.
And I turned down meetings all the time and booked up for years and years and years. And so that's a good thing for an evangelist. And thank you for supporting me and financially and prayer-wise and all the little pats on the back this morning and those little comments. She's pretty. They are pretty. My head got about that big. Amen. I said, yes, sir. They are. They are. And thank you for all those good comments. Well, Psalms 139 again, if you'll turn there. And Psalms 139, we're going to read a little bit in Psalms 139 every night. But we're going to read Psalms 139, say a few things about it. Then we're going to shoot over to the New Testament, to a book by the name of Colossians. Colossians chapter 3. And I have been a fundamental Baptist preacher now for 49 years. And that's a long time. Got saved on a Sunday morning in a little Southern Baptist church. Don't let that hurt you now. But I got saved in a little Southern Baptist church on the corner of I and Ellis Street in Brunswick, Georgia, on a Sunday morning. And preached my first revival the following week, and I've been preaching ever since. And God has been good. God has been good to me. And I don't know very much, but what I know, I rejoice in.
Amen.
Amen. And God's been good. God's been good to this preacher, and God's been good to you too, Welch Creek Baptist Church. And but in fundamentalism in our circle, we preach against everything. Our churches preach against everything. I heard a preacher one time preach on in the death in the pot. Have you ever heard that? The death in the pot. He had a big old black pot down in front of the pulpit, and he had everything in the under the sun in that pot. And in the very bottom of that pot, he had a candy bar. I won't ever forget. I was just a young preacher in my 20s, and he had that candy bar, Brother Tommy, down in, oh, the very last thing he preached on was Snicker bars. And that's my favorite, amen. And I thought, good night, he's preaching against my candy bar. And so I asked him, I said, brother, what is wrong with eating a candy bar? He said, the temple. And he said, candy bars, it has a lot of sugar in it. And he was a health food nut. And he said, they'll rot your teeth out. And he said, it's a sin. And I said, oh, okay. But I won't never forget that. But we preach against everything. We just jump on everything. But it's dawned on me in the last couple of years that when we really preach the Bible and really preach the pure word of God, seem like people just don't like it. But boy, when we preach all these preferences and pump the emotions of people and you know, that type of preaching, people just eats it up. But it don't last. It don't last. About before the evangelist even gets out of town, good, the people's already going back to the old ways. And we need something that will last. And let me tell you, this book is going to last.
Yes, it will.
And it will last.
That's right.
And if we'll follow it, then we can have revival. But tonight I'm going to read verse 1 of Psalms 139, and then we're going to shoot over to Colossians, and it's going to really hit you. I've been preaching it now for over a year and a half, almost 2 years, and it's going to really hit you hard. And I've had preachers to tell me, Brother Beckham, I've never looked at it that way. I've had deacons to tell me, I've had them to come up to me after the service during the invitation, said, I've never heard such preaching in my life than what you are bringing out of the book of Colossians, Brother Beckham. I didn't realize that. And many of you will say the same thing tonight, I guarantee you. Because like I said, we preach against everything, but we really don't preach against sin. And anything the Bible tells us to do and we don't do it, it's sin. Amen. And boy, Colossians is full. It's full of good, solid teaching. If a church will follow Colossians 3, they'll stay in the spirit of revival. If just Colossians 3, if a church will do everything, Colossians 3, that you'll stay, your home will stay in place. I mean, you'll be in place, and you'll see the glory of God in your life. Let's read Psalms 139, verse 1. The Bible says, and I believe David said it somewhat like this. And David said it like this because he was pierced. His old pride had went out the window, and David had been pierced and dug into. And when you swallow your old pride, and when you realize God knows everything about you, and you're nothing but you, even your righteousness is nothing but filthy, right? And when you realize you're nothing, let me tell you something. And God knows everything about you. Let me tell you, that's when God can use you. But as long as you puffed up with pride and you think you're really something, God can't use you. God can't use Brother Benny. I had to come to the point in my life that I realized I was a nothing and I was helpless without God. And that's when God began to do something in my life. And that's the only time God's going to do something in your life. Now look at it. I believe he said it somewhat like this. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Thou hast searched me. God, you have dug into me, pierced me, and known me. The amazing thing about that is that God knows us and he still loves us. That's the amazing thing of that verse. Let's talk to the Father a little bit. Father, I love you and you love me. I don't understand how, but you do. And Lord, I pray tonight as we, the church begins to look at the book of Colossians. And Lord, as you speak to us, as you dig into us, as you pierce into us, Lord, I pray that Benny Beckham will be honest. And Lord, I pray Welch Creek Baptist Church will be honest. Lord, I'm not here. You know I'm not here to entertain. I'm not here to impress. Lord, I'm not here to work on their emotions. Lord, I'm just here to preach your book and help me to do it. Help me to do it with conviction. Help me to do it being sensitive to the needs of my brothers and my sisters. Help me to do it with compassion. And Lord, if I can't, help me to sit down and just be quiet. And Father, thank you now for salvation. There may be someone here tonight, Lord, that's lost. If there is, I pray they'll, in their free will turn to you, repent of their sins, cry upon you to save their soul. Oh my. Lord, again, I just want to say, I love you. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to preach one more time. Thank you so much. Sure love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Colossians. Now, we're going to just take verse by verse. We're going to just take it slowly. We're not going to try to preach a bunch, the whole chapter tonight. We have three more nights, and we're not going to get done with it. I'll tell you that right now. We're not going to get done with Colossians 3, but we're going to get as much of it as we can. I want you to notice in verse 1 of chapter 3. Now, I want to say this again. When God tells us to do something and we do not do it, it's sin. Now, James 4:17 says, if we know to do good and doeth it not, it's sin. Psalm 66:18 says, if we regard iniquity in our heart, then the Lord will not hear us. Not answer our prayer. He won't even hear you. He won't even hear you. It's not saying he won't answer your prayer. He won't even hear you pray if you have iniquity in your heart, if you love it and cherish it and not willing to repent of it. And so, see, we got a lot of people with cancer here in Welch Creek. We got a lot of people facing problems. Got a lot of problems around here. Amen. Amen. A lot of your family, people that's not even members of this church. We have young men and young ladies overseas fighting right now, being shot at, that we need to pray for. We have a president, a White House. Amen. Congress, Senate, House of Representatives, all these people to pray for. We have a church to pray for. And see, if we're not doing Colossians chapter 3, we're in gross sin. We're in rebellion against God. And until we get back to this, we'll never have revival. Now, you'll have meetings. You'll have good preaching. But you're not going to have revival. Amen? We need revival. We need revival. And we need preaching with application. All these evangelists preaching all these glory messages and things. It's not doing nothing, Brother Baker. It's not getting, and once in a while we need a little bit of glory preaching, but we don't need it for a diet. And that's what they're doing across America. And we're not having revival. We're just having good meetings and a lot of noise. But very few revivals here in the South. And so now I want you to look at it with me now in Colossians chapter 3. That word "if," I want you to look at it. That word "if" means since. Since ye then be risen with Christ, there are some things that God's going to look at in your life, in my life right now. And I want you to notice it says, since you are born again, since you have been resurrected with Christ, the Bible says, not Brother Beckham, the Bible says in Colossians 3:1 that we are to seek, and notice what it says, seek those things which are above where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Now, I've asked preachers' wives, I've asked pastors, I've asked deacons, I've asked Sunday school teachers, I've asked the lay people of the church, are you seeking God? Are you seeking the things of God on a daily basis? Do you do it on a daily basis? Is your mind seeking the things of God? You said, Brother Beckham, I've never thought of that before. That's just not one of those things I think about. But let me tell you, that's one of the essential things to have victory in your life. See, we're not preaching that. And when men does preach it, they don't preach it that it's a sin if you're not seeking God. And that's one reason why our churches are falling apart, because we have a bunch of people that sitting there thinking they're spiritual because they read a King James Bible and they tote it around and they dress right and they look right and they do all those things, and so they think they are spiritual. But let me tell you, there's something else that we are to do, church. Yes. Since we have been resurrected with Christ, amen, we are to be seeking God. I preach this and I see people just under conviction. I mean, right off the bat, they've run to the altar. They said, Brother Beckham, I didn't know not seeking God on a daily basis was a sin. How, when you said that, I couldn't sit in my seat any longer. Have you ever thought about that? You're not seeking God, your mind on the things of God. Oh, my soul. So let me just ask you tonight, Welch Creek Baptist Church, are you seeking God? You say, Preacher, I'm not. Brother Beckham, I'm not. Well, you're in sin. Yes. And if you're in sin, you can't even pray. How in the world can God send revival to you if you're not seeking God? Now look at point 2, verse 2. The Bible is God is searching into our hearts. He's looking deeply. He's piercing. I mean, he is digging deeply into our hearts right now. And look at the second thing. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Can I go back to verse on that seeking before I go to set? Look in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. There's something that God is really driving in here. We are not just to seek God, but we are to seek God number one. If God's not number one in your life, if there's a job more important, if there's a career, if there's whatever it might be more important than God, guess what? You're in sin again. You're in sin again. And listen to what the Bible says. Brother Beckham didn't write this. Brother Baker didn't write it. No other preacher did. But the Holy Ghost led great men to write this. Holy men. Now look at this. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto. But seek ye first the kingdom of God. See, we read that and we just look at it like, well, if I can, I will. It's kind of optional, Brother Beckham, right? This stuff is optional. No, it's not optional. God says to do it, we are to do it. And we are not just to seek God, but we are to seek God first, and God should be first in our lives. Amen. And let me just ask you, Welch Creek Baptist Church, you're a great church. I love you all my heart. But let me just ask you, is God number one in your heart? Is God number one? Is he number two, number three, number four? If he is, you're in sin. You're in sin. You're in open sin. You're in open rebellion against God. And boy, we don't like that, do we? We don't like our ears. Our old flesh doesn't like that kind of preaching. We like to be pumped up and shout and holler and make a bunch of noise. But we don't need that. I'll say it again. We need the pure word. And God says, now, Welch Creek, if you want revival, you seek me and you seek me first. And then he says in verse 2, he says, set Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. Now, you say, well, Brother Beckham, what does that mean? That means that word affection means your mind. Your mind should be on things above and not on things on the earth. And we are to set and focus our mind on the things of God. You say, how in the world can I do that? Look in Romans 8. Verse 5 and 6. Now, we don't hear much preaching in Baptist churches on the abundant life or the surrendered life or the, you don't hear any preaching on that, not in fundamental circles. You don't hear much on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. R.A. Torrey preached the baptism. D.L. Moody preached the baptism of the Holy Ghost and all that. A lot of people said to, well, Brother Beckham, that's Pentecostal doctrine. No, it's not. Let me show you something. This spirit-filled life is a Bible doctrine. And we need to get back to it. I'm trying my best to learn to do this. Romans 8, verse 5 and 6. For they that are after the flesh, do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded, or the minding of the flesh, is death. But to be spiritually minded, or the minding of the Spirit, is life and peace. So, how can we seek God and be a seeker of God? Be spirit-filled. And if you're spirit-filled, you're not going to fulfill the things of the flesh. Church time, you're going to be at church. Tithing time, you're going to tithe. Amen. Soul winning time, you're going to be a soul winner. And on and on and on and on. The Spirit of God always prays in the will of God. If you want to be in the will of God all the time, just walk in the Spirit.
Yes.
Amen. That's the key. That's the key. But Baptist churches are not preaching that because we don't want to be tagged with the Pentecostals. But I don't care. Go ahead and tag me. Go ahead and put me in the Pentecostal movement. It really doesn't matter because I know I'm not, and I know I'm preaching the book. And so someone said, Brother Beckham, how can I be focused? Walk in the Spirit. And when you walk in the Spirit, let me tell you something else. You'll be joyful. You'll be happy. You'll have peace. You'll have temperament. You'll be long-suffering. You'll have all the cluster of the, all nine of the fruit. Not fruits, but fruit. There's nine parts of it, and you'll have every one of them if you're a seeker and if you're focused. But church, let me ask you. See, I believe in preaching and in applying it. See, a lot of evangelists nowadays, they just come in, they preach a little generalized message and no application, no nothing, and people can just walk out feeling good about it. But when you preach it like Jesus did, like Paul did, and like those old patriarchs of the Old Testament, they applied it. They just looked you right in the eyeball and said, this is what you should be doing, and if you're not doing it, sin.
Yeah.
Wow. And that's what we need today. So let me ask you, Welch Creek Baptist Church, are you seeking? Are you set? Are you focused? And you folks may be. You right here, you may be, but you may not be. So let me ask you right now, are you a seeker? Are you focused on the things of God? Or are you kind of like a yo-yo, up and down, in and out? Read your Bible for 2 or 3 days, gun-ho, and then not read it for 4 or 5 months.
Yes.
Same way. Now, look, I want you to notice something else. In verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall he also appear with him in glory. Look in verse 3, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Who is our Christ? Who is our life? I was preaching in our national meeting last year in Maryland. And the place was full, and we had guest speakers. We had the new preacher at Hammond, Indiana there, Brother Wilkinson. We had Daryl Cox there, and we had all these guys preaching. But I was preaching that particular night, and I walked down among the people, and I asked this old preacher, I said, is Christ your life? Old white-headed guy, about 75. He's in heaven. He went to be with the Lord just a few months ago. And he looked at me and he said, "Brother Beckham, Christ is my life." I said, "Would you stand up and tell this church that? Would you stand up right?" Boy, he stood up, put his hands up in the air, and he just kind of shouted it out. "Christ is my life." I thought, wow. But let me ask you a question. What if Brother Baker said, "Church, I want everybody in this building that is seeking God, that is focused, and will say, 'Christ is my life.' I want you to come up here, line up, and stand behind this podium tonight and tell everybody, 'I'm a seeker, I'm focused, I'm going to stay focused, and Christ is my life.'" I wonder how many of you, how many of Welch Creek people could do that. I said that not long ago in a church, and boy, conviction set in. I mean, it was something else. We had a great revival. People got right with God. They said, "Brother Beckham, I sat there, I heard you say that," and I said, "Oh my goodness, I hope my pastor won't ask me to do that tonight." I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. But many of them could do it after the invitation. So let me ask you, if he did ask you to do that, how many of you would be willing to do it? Would be willing to do it? I guarantee you, if you went to your job in the morning and that superintendent came out and called everybody in a conference room and said, "Now look, to keep your job, you got to give all to this company. You got to do this and do that." I guarantee you would do everything you could do to keep that job. Amen? But we won't do that in the spiritual realm. And that's the reason why our churches are in a mess like they are. Because we have people in them that is not wanting to really be what they should be. And you're not what you should be unless you're seeking, setting, and Christ is your life. And then when we come to verse 5, we're going to kind of camp ground here on verse 5. And I want you to look at verse 5 with me. And people says, "Brother Beckham, what does any of this have to do with prayer?" It has everything to do with prayer. Because, see, these are the essentials to a prayer life. Colossians chapter 3 is the essential qualifications to a prayer life. And look in verse 5 with me. The Bible says, "Mortify." Now that word "mortify" means that we are to put to death. We are to kill some things in our lives. Amen. Now notice what it says. "Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth." Fornication. Fornication. Now, I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 18. What is fornication, Brother Beckham? It includes all forms of immorals and sexual acts. Now, I don't know what's going on in our churches across America, but I'll tell you this. The sexual movement among independent Baptists and Pentecostal churches too, they tell me this thing of fornication is destroying ministries and homes across this country. Look at what the Bible says. 1 Corinthians 6:18, "Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body." Flee fornication. That's a solemn command of God, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
And the command means man should escape from it. He should not stay to reason with it. He's not to debate the matter. He is to flee from it, get away from it. Amen. I'm telling you. You say, "Brother Beckham, I don't have a problem with that." Well, good. Hallelujah. But the flesh is weak. I'm telling you, It's weak. And God says, notice what else he says here. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. It wastes the body's energy, produces feebleness, weakness, and disease. It impairs the strength. It enervates the man. It shortens the life. And when I look at fundamental churches, I'm thinking, wow, the biggest church, the largest church in America, the pastor was caught in fornication. He's serving 12 years in prison tonight. I preached for another preacher that is serving 8 years in prison because he didn't flee fornication. Our men in these are independent fundamental Baptist churches, and these men were in their 50s, almost 60s, messing around with 12, 13, 14 year old girls. And listen, you say, well, preacher, I would never do that. You better be careful. If you're in the flesh, you might do it. Amen. We need to flee it. We don't need to be flirting around with this fornication. And there's no way there isn't. And one of these guys wrote numerous books on the home life and loving your husband and loving your wife and all this stuff. And he was doing all this stuff as he was writing and preaching all this country. You know why? Because he didn't flee. He thought he could handle it. You can't handle it. Brother Beckham can't handle it. Brother Baker can't handle it. We are to mortify fornication. And then notice something else it says here. Since we have been risen with Christ. Somebody said, Brother Beckham, why should I do this? Because you have been risen with Christ.
That's right.
You claim to be a Christian. You claim to be saved. You claim to you go into heaven when you die. This should be, I mean, this is should be just old common stuff.
That's right.
But it's not. I'm not seeing it. I'm not seeing it. And then he says, flee fornication. And then he says, uses the word uncleanness. This is speaking of moral impurity. Doing things that are dirty, that pollutes, soils your life. Look in Ephesians 5:3. Now, you said, Brother Beckham, I'm not doing any of this stuff. Why don't you just go on? Well, somebody might be.
Yeah, preacher.
Amen. Somebody might be.
Yeah.
Now, notice, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Now, church, listen to me. Are you hearing what the Word of God is saying? Flee fornication. We fundamentalists, we read that like if we want to or if we're convicted. One man said, Brother Beckham, I'm just not convicted about some of this stuff. I'm not. It doesn't matter, sir, whether you're convicted or not. It's still the Bible. And the Bible says to flee from it. And the Bible says here, it says, but fornication and all uncleanness, let it not be once named among you, has become a saint. So anything that's dirty shouldn't be in our lives.
That's right.
Filthy stuff. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Clean up. Why, preacher? Because you've been resurrected. You've been risen with Christ. And notice with me again. I'm going to read it to you again because some of you are kind of looking around here. But it says, but fornication and all uncleanness, covetousness, let it not be one. Let it not be one. Let it not be one's name among you as saints of God. But boy, it is. Everywhere I go, I'm finding dirty things. Pastors bring, one guy said, we have so much. He said, I know that we have so much whiskey and beer and wine in our church, we could start a liquor store on our own. That's what he said to his church. One of the strongest churches in North Carolina. Runs over 800 and soul winning. I mean, they have some every night at that church. And boy, when he said that, I thought, whoa, boy, the shepherd knows the flock. And he said, we will never have revival until you get that stuff out of your house. get all the dirty stuff and bring, and let's get rid of it. Let's clean up our church, he said. Boy, filled up four trash cans. Baptist church, independent, fundamental. No mixed women, no movie going. Baptist church. Yeah. He said, wow. And then I want you to notice the next thing. Inordinate affections. Inordinate affections. What is that, preacher? That's passion. That's craving. That's strong desire. That's a driving lust. And it amazed me, Brother Baker, at the drinking preachers that we have in fundamental circles. Preachers that will tell me, Brother Baker, I don't see a thing wrong with drinking a beer once in a while. I don't see one thing wrong going out and drinking a glass of wine. I just don't see nothing wrong with it. I don't see one thing, preacher, wrong with smoking a cigar or this. I just don't see nothing wrong with it. Boy, we went fishing one night. I was at a camp meeting. And boy, we went fishing. And they had mosquitoes as big as buzzards. I'm telling you, those things came flying down. And they just suck all the blood out of you at one time. It was done. And the preacher left. And he came back and he had a cigar box. Well, Granddad had a cigar box, but he had hooks and sinkers and all that in his. And I thought, well, the preacher's just got a bunch of hooks and sinkers. And so I thought, well, okay. And all of a sudden, I started smelling something. Smelled pretty good, be honest with you. But I looked around, and there they are, preachers. Those cigars was that long, that big around. And they were smoking those things. And he walked up to me and he said, Brother Bacon, you want one? I said, no, sir. No, sir. So this mosquito came down. Landed on me, sucked all my blood out. And I thought, well, Lord, I know you love me. Wouldn't be that bad to just puff on one, huh? And the Holy Ghost said, you better not. So I got between two that was smoking. To keep them off of me. Amen. And let the Lord whip them, but I'm going to get the benefit of it. But boy, man, them things are eating me up. And but alcohol and smoking preachers and boy, drugs, preachers that are drugged up. Lay people that are drugged up. And I'm not talking about illegal drugs. I'm talking about these prescription drugs. Boy, so many people are doped up in our churches. I'm telling you, it's amazing. A young lady told me she lost her career, lost everything, just messed up her life. And she's told me, she said, I want you to use me for an exam. I want you to tell everybody about my life. Oh boy, she had got caught stealing and got locked up in jail and all kind of stuff for a day or two. And it was a mess. It was a mess. And I looked at her and I said, you want me to tell everybody your story? Yes, sir. I want you to tell them who I am too. I said, are you sure? Because I go all the country, honey. I go out of the country. You want everybody to know hey, I need prayer. I want people to know who I am. I want them to pray. Well, she said, Brother Beckham, do you know this young lady? Yeah, I know her real well. She's my daughter. And boy, she got messed up. I'm telling you, just goofed up, just ruined her life. And now about 2 years later, she's getting her nursing license back, and she's doing a lot of things. She got cleaned up, back in church, doing well. But let me tell you, it was hard. And it wasn't the illegal drugs either. It was this prescription stuff. And boy, people walks in, they're all out of their mind, doped out of their mind. People of churches, we need to get that straightened out. Amen. And then pornography. I mentioned it this morning. We having trouble with it in our Bible colleges, but churches, churches. Preachers are saying my deacons are addicted to porno, preacher. My Sunday school teachers, what can I do? I said, you can't do one thing but preach the Holy Ghost. And the person that's doing it is going to have to do it. Amen. Get cleaned up. That stuff will ruin your home. It will ruin your home. It will ruin your church. It will destroy you. How can I do it, preacher? Look in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 16, 17, and 24. Now, this is a sure proof. This is a sure proof if you'll do this. I've already said it one time tonight, but I'm going to show it to you in the Bible. Look at it. This I say then, walk in the Spirit. And you might not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's not what it says, is it? The Bible says, walk in the Spirit and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, all these worldly people that are members of our churches, Brother Baker, and they claim to be spiritual and they sing in the choir and they do all this stuff. Let me tell you, if you're fleshly, you're walking after the flesh. I said to a good church last week, I said, preacher, would you let someone drinking liquor sing in this choir? He has a wonderful choir like you all. He said, no, sir. I said, would you let someone that's looking at pornography and all this stuff and you know about it, sing in your choir, teach Sunday? No, sir, I wouldn't do it. I said, but you'll let someone that's not seeking God sing in the choir. You'll let someone that's not focused sing in the choir. You'll let someone that won't admit that Christ is their life sing in the choir. You'll let somebody that is doing other things, not mortifying the deeds of the flesh, sing in the choir. Boy, he told me later, he said, Brother Bingham, I've never thought of that kind of stuff. He said, I've never thought about this being sin. I said, preacher, anything that God says to do and we don't do it, it's sin. He said, I wouldn't have very many up there. I said, well, good. At least the ones that's up there would be right with God. Hello?
Yes.
Boy. Look at it. Look at verse 17. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary, the one of the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. For they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. So all these bitter people, all these honoring people in the church, they fleshly. If you walk in the Spirit, you're going to have the fruit of the Spirit in your life. And when Brother Benny gets all bent out of shape, I'm in the flesh. When I'm not seeking, I'm in the flesh. When I'm not focused, I'm in the flesh. Everybody's, they have nicknamed me the beloved evangelist. And then some of the preachers are calling me the living room preacher now. Brother Beckham, you're the living room preacher. Yeah, it's just like you just walk into our church and you just talk to us like you were in our living room. I said, well, amen, hallelujah, I'll be the living room preacher. But notice something here. Walk in the Spirit and you shall not fulfill the things of the flesh. Now let me ask you, look up here for a minute. Are you seeking? Are you setting? Is he your life? Is he number one? Are you mortifying? You say, preacher, I'm not. Guess what? You're in the flesh. Boy. That's pretty strong stuff right there, isn't it? And but that right there will bring revival. See, if you're not doing this stuff, how in the world can God bless? That's just as much teaching as go ye. Boy, we put a lot of emphasis on that go ye, don't we? On soul winning. But everywhere I go, I hear soul winning. But I don't hear much preaching on seeking. Don't hear much seeking on preaching on setting and mortifying. Boy, I hear a lot of preaching on missions. I hear a lot of preaching on preaching. Preach the word. Well, okay, preach Colossians chapter 3. Preach it with conviction. Amen.
Amen.
Well, boy. And then notice something else we are to mortify. Evil concupiscence. What is that, Brother Beckham? It's sexual desires. It's lust. It's evil desires. It's a yearning and an aching for all kinds of evil. It is within a person that pulls him to that desire. Oh, my. You say, well, Brother Beckham, I'm not guilty of that terrible sin. Well, look in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3 down to verse 5 with me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3 through 5. For this is the will of God. For this is the will of God. Even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication. It says flee from fornication, flee from all uncleanness, and abstain from fornication. Well, Brother Beckham, does it really mean? What does abstain mean? Abstain. Yeah, simple. Boy. And then it says that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the lusts of concupiscence, even as the Gentiles which know not God. Don't be like the people, like the Gentiles that don't even know God. If you're going to claim to be risen with Christ, do this stuff.
Yes.
That's the reason why we can't get anyone in the church, because they look at us. They don't see any difference in us. I was preaching in North Carolina again a few years ago, and sometimes I'll go door knocking. I don't even tell the preacher. I just go door knocking. And I went door knocking this house right next door to the church. I walked over, knocked on the door. The couple came to the door, and I said, I'm Benny Beckham. I'm the evangelist. I'm preaching next door. And I just would like to invite you all over. We're not coming. I mean, just like that. We're not coming. Well, I said, well, may I ask why? And they said, we work with some of them. We work with some of them. Well, I said, I'm sorry. I take it that they don't live like a Christian on the job then, right? Yes, preacher. Well, I went back to my room. I thought, wow, this is terrible. Terrible. I walked in, sat on the front row like I always do. They did their singing for about 45 minutes to an hour. Finally, I got up there to preach. I looked out. I took off my glasses, tears running down my face. I said, church, I went out door knocking today. And I knocked on the door next door to you. And I asked them to come to church. And they told me, without batting their eyes, they wouldn't come. And I said, you know why they won't come to your church? Because they work with some of you. I said, some of you right here tonight are not living the Christian life on the job. And that couple next door may go to hell because of you. Boy, oh boy. The choir, I mean, people started moving and going to the altar. We had a good revival. But you just have to be honest sometimes, Brother Becky. And if you do it in love and compassion, people accept it. I didn't holler at them and get mad at them and call them everything under the sun. I just told them the truth. And many of them got right with the Lord. And so, look at the last one now. Covetousness. That's craving. That's grabbing. Desiring to have something. It's desiring to have something when it's not needed. It's desiring more than what we need and more than what we should have. And then that turns into idolatry.
Yes, it does.
And oh my. Boy, we preach against the Catholic Church. I got some friends that preaches against the Catholic Church all the time. That's all they want to do, preach against the Catholic Church. I told them one day, I said, your church is worse than the Catholic Church. She said, boy, you're tough, Brother Benny. You call us atheists, you call us Catholics, you call us all these things. And he said, what you mean? I said, just what I said. I didn't bat my eye. I love him. He loves me. We talk plain to one another. But I said, sir, I said, buddy, you preach against the Catholic Church all the time. I said, he said, they got all them idols in there, Brother Beckham. They walk in and they do this number and they do all this stuff at these statues. And he said, they worship those statues. And we need to preach against that stuff, Brother Benny. I said, how about all those idols that's in your members' mind and in their heart? Yeah. I said, that's worse than having them hanging up on the wall. He bowed his head. He said, I've never thought about it. Things that people worship. Amen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Things that we worship. Bass boat. Deer stand. Usually I get the church name. That way it keeps me out of trouble. But you know the number one thing among fundamentalists right now that is tearing up churches. Can anyone name it? God uses it more than anything else in the fundamental church. Can anyone name that tool that the devil is using?
Recreation.
No, sir. Let me tell you. Let me tell you something that happened to Jeanette and I. When I asked her to marry me in October, I wanted her to sing. And she did a wonderful job. She always does. But that particular night, everybody wanted me to announce the invitation. And I wanted to wait until a particular time to do it. And I think it was Wednesday night. And Jeanette got up to sing. And she did the song that she did tonight, The Love of God, did a wonderful job. But she thought she messed up. And she turned around. Now, I didn't hear her, but the church heard her and the pastor heard her. I must have been in dreamland somewhere. I don't know. But I didn't hear her. But she looked at me. They said that she looked at me and said, babe, I'm sorry. Babe, I'm sorry. Well, I didn't hear. So she got down and I started walking up to the platform. And the preacher said, Brother Beckham, I think it's a good time to tell the church, because she just called you babe in front of the whole church and the whole world, because it was being broadcast over the internet. And I said, she did what? She just called you babe. I said, oh, okay. Within just minutes, 188 hits on the FaceTime. 188 hits just to hear Jeanette say to Brother Beckham, babe. But what is amazing to me is, people will leave the church service and they'll go home and get on that idol and they'll talk for hours and they'll broadcast things that they shouldn't broadcast. Amen? That's one of those idols. Now, it could be used, I guess, good in good ways, but not what I'm hearing. Pastors are telling me, I wish they would do away with that FaceTime stuff, Brother Beckham. I have more trouble with FaceTime. People that does the FaceTime said, I can preach on something and everybody in the country knows about it before I even get home good. Why does it get quiet when we start talking about this stuff? You know why? Because we're guilty. Amen. And so it turns into an idol. I know preachers that loves golf. I got an evangelist friend. He's on the golf course at 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning. And he preaches as much as I do. He preaches as many meetings as I do. But he plays every day. Every day from 7 in the morning, 8 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the afternoon and preaches at night. Every day of his ministry. Every day, preacher. Not once in a while. And good preacher. Well-known preacher. If I call his name, you may know him here in the South. I'm not sure. But he's well-known. Big time. But he golfs every day. I said, I just don't understand that. Idols. What is your idol? Now, here's the questions. Are you doing those five things? I love you. But don't be telling people you love God if you're not doing those things. Don't you walk out of Welch Creek Baptist Church and claim to be spiritual if you're not doing those things. If Brother Beckham, if I'm not doing those things, hey, I'm in open sin. But Brother Beckham, I just don't see it the way you see it. I read it straight out of the book. There's no other way to see it. Since you have been risen with Christ, seek. What other way can you see that? Since you have been risen with Christ, set your mind on things above. What other way can you see that? Make Christ your life. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first. How can you see it any other way? There's no other way to look at it. It's either, see, Christ has dug, he looked into your heart tonight. And the reason it's so quiet. See, in the South, we say, well, the devil's walked in. It kind of got tight. Well, when it gets tight, that's when God's walked in.
Yes.
That's what I'm learning.
Yeah.
It's not the devil walking in when it gets tight. And a lot of times when it's noisy, God's not 100 miles from the place. That's not popular in the South. I'm not getting any more popular in the South. But I tell you, it's either yes or no. So take your mental picture, your mental notebook, and check yes or no to seeking. Yes or no to setting. And let's see how spiritual you really are. And if you don't have all yeses, you need to come to the altar and say, God, forgive me. Yes. If you're really born again.
Yes.
It might be that the reason you don't do those five things, you're just a church member. You just prayed a little prayer sometime, and you think you're saved. Because you prayed a little 1, 2, 3 prayer. A lot of staff. Guy came up in a big church, came up to me and said, Brother Beckham, I'm on the staff here, but I'm not even saved. I said, go and tell your preacher. Let him win you to it. He got saved that night. Preacher, staff member. Yes, sir. Living for God now. Boy, he's happy. Brother Tommy, he's happy as he can be. So where are you at tonight? You got a city to win? Got a county to win? Got a job to do here in Walterboro?
Right.
Got a lot of family that's... How many of you got family members lost? Yeah, every one of you. How many of you know someone that's sick needs your prayers?
Yeah.
So see, it's very important to make sure these things are in place. If they're not, you need to come right down here tonight. And if you can't come to the altar because of physical problems, just kneel right there in that pew. Sit right there in that pew and ask God to forgive you. And let's just start off tonight, amen, being honest with God. And boy, come back in here tomorrow night just wanting to do the will of God, amen. Because see, tomorrow night We're going to talk about that verse 7, 8, and 9, or 8, 9, and 10. Since we have been risen with Christ, put off. See, a lot of people still wearing old rags of the old man. But that's just, those are the essentials to the prayer life. So, Brother Benny wants you to be able to pray. But God wants you to be able to pray to him too. So where are you at tonight? Let's stand as our pianist comes. Now, sister, if you want to leave that piano, we don't have to have music. A lot of times we don't have any music in our invitations because the piano players wants to go to the altars. So as she begins to play, just check. Are you seeking? Are you setting? And if you're not, don't stand there and slap God in the face with your life. Because he's already pierced you. He knows. So you mind the Lord. Just mind the Lord. Everybody. Every member. You give an invitation to the average church, about 5%, 10% runs to the same ones every Sunday. That's not the way it should be. When the Word of God is preached, there's no perfect people in here. There's nobody in here that does everything God tells us to do. We come up short. That's the reason why the invitation is given. Every heart should be praying, God, forgive me. Yeah, as she plays. I know. You said, Brother Beckham, boy, this is, I thought revival was hooping and hollering and getting pumped up. No. You read about the great revivals in the Bible. You don't see that stuff. Well, there's conviction. And see, revival's not for the lost. That's the amazing thing to me. Revival's for the church. If the church gets right with God, we would see a lot of people get saved. Yeah. That's the reason why it takes longer than a week. Dr. Cox told me, he said, Brother Beckham, boy, 3/4 of my church got right with God. Runs 900. And he said, can you stay another week? I said, if the preacher will let me, I'll call ahead and see. And I was scheduled to preach for Keith Gomez in Illinois. I had never been with Brother Keith Gomez. Boy, I was excited about preaching for that great man of God. And I called him and I said, preacher, boy, I'm in a revival and the preacher wants me to stay and people's getting right with God and flying in from foreign countries and everywhere to be a part of this revival. He said, Brother Bam, if you're having revival, you stay there. Don't you come to Illinois. And that's the way it was every week. God just, you can read about it. I read this morning there were 70 saved and over 300 confessed sin publicly. Yeah. Boy, we had a time. Well, tomorrow night we'll start the testimony thing. And that's when we'll give you an opportunity to confess. You get right with God, then you tell the church, I got right with God, I got this out of my life, got that out of my life. And we'll start that. We do it sometimes on Sunday night. I just don't feel led to do it tonight. But tomorrow night, if the Lord leads, we'll give you an opportunity to share what God's done in your heart. Amen. And you pray now. The devil don't like this. The devil don't like Bible preaching. He likes that generalized stuff. He likes that entertainment. Because, see, he don't like this conviction stuff, because he knows that it does surgery to the heart. Amen. So you pray for Jeanette, Julie, and I, and pray that we can just be what we need to be in front of our churches. Amen. It's easy to stand up here and preach a little bit, but I don't want to just preach it. I want to live it. Amen. Okay. All right, Brother Baker. Love you, church. Thank you.
Oh, boy. You hear what he said? A heart surgery? Boy. Well, someone said going to have heart surgery at the Roper Hospital. Well, we had heart surgery here tonight, didn't we? God, has it affected your heart? It should. It should. It better. Amen, amen. The great sins of omission, not doing what God says to do. Just as bad as the sins of commission. All right. Well, listen, preacher, you and your wife step back to the foyer. Got some good literature back there. Please look through it, look at it, examine it. It's good reading. And like I said, if it was something else, you might look at it. You know, if we had some Clemson, Carolina hats back there, you'd buy them. Wear them a week or two and throw them away. There's some good literature back there that your family would enjoy. You'd enjoy. Hope you look through it and get some, okay? All right. Let's pray and be dismissed. Now, Holy Spirit, we have felt your presence tonight. And I pray as we make our way to our homes that, Lord, your same penetrating conviction and presence will go with us. And, Lord, that you'll do in each of us what you would want to do. And, Lord, we want to allow ourselves to you to do that. And so, God, we pray now you'll help us. Watch over Brother Beckham and his wife and the family, Lord. Give them, Lord, a good night's rest. We pray for tomorrow, Lord, that you'll help us to be a good witness and a good testimony in all that we say and do. Thank you for loving us, being so good to us. Watch over us now as we're dismissed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. See you tomorrow night. Get here early so we pray now, okay?